Hi, this is Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting video 11.2 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This video discusses how to achieve a closure of a femoral access site using the AngioShield device. Closure is the 11th of the 14 steps of percutaneous coronary intervention and usually marks the end of the case. Video 11.1 discusses in detail about how to achieve closure, whether to use manual pressure or use a closure device. In general, closure devices can be used in arteries that are more than 5 millimeters in diameter without significant disease and without having access at a bifurcation. Also, specifically for the AngioShield, high stick should be avoided, and the reason is that if the collagen plug is inserted high, it can be stuck inside the muscle and fascia layers and then cause delayed bleeding from the femoral tireotomy and retroperitoneal hematoma. So AngioShield should not be used for high sticks. This is the mechanism of action of the AngioShield. Essentially, it creates a sandwich of the wall. There's three components. One is the anchor that is placed inside the femoral artery. There is also a collagen plug, and there is a suture that connects the two. And all three components are bioresorbable. The anchor is deployed inside the vessel, and then the collagen plug is compacted using a small device that pushes it from the top. The size of the plug, collagen plug, depends on the size of the arteriotomy. The plug is significantly larger for the 8 French device and smaller for the 6 French device. These are the components of the system. We do have the AngioShield sheath, a dilator, and the AngioShield device that contains the anchor, the suture, and the collagen plug. And also there is a guide wire that comes with the system. It comes in two sizes, one for 6 French that can also be used for 7 French, and one that is 8 French that can also be used for 9 French. This is how the AngioShield device looks like. It contains the anchor that goes inside the vessel, the suture, as well as the collagen sponge that causes hemostasis. This is how the AngioShield looks 1 month later, obtaining access in the same vessel. So although this is starting to get absorbed, there is still some residual of the anchor inside the vessel. It does take 2 to 3 months for the components of the AngioShield device to be absorbed, and that is why it is best to avoid reaccessing the same femoral artery within the first 3 months after using an AngioShield device. How is the AngioShield closure done? It is done in 8 steps, and we'll go over them one by one. The first one is to prepare the AngioShield device, which is done by inserting the dilator inside the AngioShield sheath. The dilator, as well as the sheath, have an inlet hole that lets the blood come in and come back through the back end of the dilator. And the purpose of this is to confirm that the AngioShield sheath is fully inside the femoral artery before deploying the anchor. The second step is to advance the wire into the arteriotomy and remove the femoral sheath. The 6 French requires an O35 wire and will not go through an O38 wire. However, the 8 French will go through either O35 or O38 wire. The wire that comes with the system is long enough for up to 25 centimeter sheaths. However, if a longer sheath is in place, for example, a 45 centimeter long sheath, then a longer guide wire needs to be used. So this is the step where the sheath is removed after we've advanced the wire enough into the artery, ideally with fluoroscopy to confirm we're high enough. And then now we have the wire going through the arteriotomy with the sheath being removed and manual pressure is held to prevent bleeding. We then advance the AngioShield device inside the artery, and this is where that blood inlet plays a key role. Once that comes into the artery, then pulsatile flow starts from the back end of the AngioShield device. As we discussed before, that inlet hole is about 1.5 centimeters from the tip of the AngioShield sheath. And this is how this looks like. Bring brisk pulsatile flow. That means that the AngioShield device sheath is at least 1.5 centimeters inside the femoral artery. The next step is to pull it back until we stop having the back bleeding, and then advance again until the brisk back bleeding starts again. And that means that now we've advanced the sheath far down enough to be back inside the femoral artery. And this is an excellent location to deliver now the angiosheath device and the anchor. So to do that, the next step is to fix the angiosheath sheath with the left hand. It is critical to not let this move at all. And then after this is done, the dilator and the guide wire are removed. Again, it's critical to fix the sheath, make sure there is no movement at all, because if it moves back, then the device will be deployed inside the subcutaneous tissue. If it goes too far into the vessel, that can be a problem as well, with potential insertion of the collagen plug inside the vessel. The next step is to insert the angiosheath device through the sheath. This is done by keeping still pressure on the sheath and then advancing the angiosheath device with small movements all the way in until the device comes in contact with the angiosheath sheath and kind of locks together. After this is done, then the next step is to deploy the anchor. And this is done by still fixing the sheath and then pulling back the angiosheath device until a click is heard and until we can see that the device is pulled back as far as can be. Now, what that does is it deploys the anchor inside the vessel, and now we can deploy the device, pull the device back, and that anchor is going to come and rest against the femoral artery wall. Caution, we have to make sure that this is pulled back all the way, because otherwise the anchor may not be fully deployed, and that will, of course, interfere with the efficacy of the device. The next step is to withdraw the device, which is done by pulling the device back. And what that does is it puts the anchor in touch with the wall of the femoral artery. It is actually important to do this first before pushing down with the tamper to avoid pushing collagen inside the femoral artery. So the device is held typically between the second and third finger of the right hand, and then it's pulled back at a 45 degree angle in a steady movement, and that again pulls the anchor against the wall of the vessel. And after this is done, then a tamper appears, and then the tamper is slowly pushed down while still maintaining traction of the device to ensure that the anchor is positioned against the wall of the vessel. And what the tamper does is it compresses the collagen so it achieves hemostasis. Two things can go wrong here. One is to pull very hard, that leads to pulling the anchor through the tracheotomy. So forceful pulling should be generally avoided, and don't use a small device for a larger sheath size. If that happens, then you need to hold manual pressure. Another potential complication is deploying the angiosheath device inside the artery. That can happen if the foot plate, the anchor, is caught in a plaque or a bifurcation. And that is why it is very important to position the sheath very accurately in the first of the beginning of the case. And now the last step of the case, step number 8, is to cut the suture. This first cut under this non-absorbable portion of the line. So it's first cut over here. And then we want to cut as short as possible, so there is not suture sticking out of the access side. And this is done in different ways. One way is to use a scissors that is open, pull down, push down as much as possible, and then pull the suture back. What that does is it cuts the suture, and then it's moved back, and now the skin comes back, and the suture remains embedded within the wall of the vessel. We'll now show a video describing all the steps one by one. The first step for closing, like with every closure device, is to first clean the access site, prep it again with an antiseptic solution. And that is to minimize the risk of infection, because infection can be a catastrophic complication of any closure device, including the angiosheath. After doing that, then we also want to make sure that the sheath is clean of any thrombus, so the sheath is aspirated and potentially flushed sometimes. Then we insert a guide wire. This is the wire that comes with the sheath. And we want to make sure that the wire is fully inserted inside the vessel so that we don't have the issue of losing access to the vessel. Here we also have a femoral vein. That's why I have to be careful not to pull out accidentally the femoral vein. The next step is to remove the sheath, holding manual pressure to prevent bleeding. Now the angiocele sheath and dilator are advanced into the vessel until we start seeing this pulsatile flow. That means we're in the vessel. So now we're pulling back until that stops, advancing again until the pulsatile flow comes again. And now we're fixing the sheath with the left hand, advancing the angiocele divides with the right hand, pulling back with deploy, then pulling the device back. We hold for 10 seconds, and now we're pushing slowly down with the tamper to compress the collagen outside the wall of the vessel and sandwich the coronary, the femoral artery wall. After we do this, we check that there is no bleeding, then we cut the suture, and then to minimize the suture that protrudes from the skin, we can use a scissors, push it down on the skin, and then cut the suture, and now there is no more suture protruding from the arteriotomy. What are the potential complications of angiocele? Like every closure device, one potential complication is bleeding, and that is why to prevent it, it's best to not use closure devices in diseased femoral arteries, and when using it, use optimal technique. As we discussed before, it should not be used, the angiocele should not be used in high sticks, because that can lead to separation of the collagen plaque from the wall of the femoral artery and cause bleeding. This is an example of an angiocele device deployed with a retroperitoneal hematoma. Second potential complication is infection, and that can be a catastrophic complication. To prevent it, the angiocele or other closure devices should generally not be used in immunocompromised patients and definitely in patients who have an active infection. And then it is best to clean the groin with an antiseptic solution before deploying the closure device. Also, it's good to change gloves. This is an example of a published case of infection of the angiocele. The patient had an angiocele and then the suture was not cut short. The patient came back later with fever, dehydration, and the pulsatile mass. It was an abscess. And to treat this is very complicated, but because of the active infection, that part of the artery had to be removed. And then there was an external iliac artery harvesting and then reconstructing the femoral artery. And then that was used in the area that was destroyed by the infection, because prosthetic material has a very high risk of getting reinfected. So major problem, it's a major operation. Therefore, every effort should be done to minimize the risk of infection of a closure device. So in summary, the angiocele is one of the most commonly used closure devices. There are 8 steps to its deployment. Carefully selecting which arteriotomies to seal with this device and using the steps one by one in a very systematic and methodical way can optimize closure, achieve hemostasis, and minimize the risk of complications. Thank you.